So it's my great pleasure to introduce the person who will introduce our first keynote speaker. Sharon Holland is my colleague here at Duke. She's associate professor in the departments of English and African-American history. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to what's going to be an amazing 2 days. It is no coincidence that the institution that birthed the radical critique of our mutually shared sexual cosmos through the work of Eve Sedgwick, among others, would also nurture the stellar career of one of its own, Professor José Muñoz. I first encountered José's work through the paradigm-shifting book, Disidentifications, Who Could Forget Vaginal Davis? In my estimation, it is a seminal work that anchored what came to be called, has come to be called, queer of color critique. But at the same time, it challenged our understanding of what an archive is, where it lives, and how to mine it for its loam, saving topsoil for other ventures more invested in the surface of things, but drawing nutrients nonetheless. Muñoz has allowed us to recognize the performativity of race and all of its attendant complexities. Professor Muñoz is also a curator, building and bringing a performance archive that showcases the work of Carmelita Tropicana, Marga Gomez, and Thomas Harris. In his essay, Feeling Brown, Muñoz again marks a trend in scholarly work that will be followed up by the work of scholars like Heather Love in Feeling Backward. For him, affect and even gesture are not just productions of positive feeling, we all like to go to that happy place, but encompass a range of aesthetic practices that not only ground narratives of historically underrepresented peoples, but also represent the pantheon of emotions that flow through them and are generated by negative encounters and experience. He asks us to consider what it would mean for us to be okay in our not so good feeling. As we sit with this in his work, we realize that this thing called the future is a utopia whose horizon we have yet to experience. He writes rather beautifully that, and I quote here, "Queerness is a structuring and educated mode of desiring that allows us to see and feel beyond the quagmire of the present. The here and now is a prison house. We must strive in the face of the here and now's totalizing rendering of reality to think and feel a then and there. Some will say that all we have are the pleasures of this moment." Thanks for the little chuckle there. But we must never settle for minimal transport. We must dream and enact new and better pleasures, other ways of being in the world, and ultimately, new worlds, end quote. I return to his work again and again for sustenance and support, for its ability, as my maternal grandmother would say, to see through muddy waters to dry sand. José Muñoz is professor of performance studies at Tisch School of the Arts, where as chair, he has put the program through a period that has literally put it on the map. He is the author of Disidentification, Queers of Color, and the Performance of Politics, Cruising Utopia, the Here and Now of Queer Futurity, and the forthcoming The Sense of Brown, which we are all seriously anticipating. His edited and co-edited collections include the volumes Pop Out, Queer Warhol, Every Night Life, Culture and Dance in Latino-Latina America, and the special issues of the journals of Social Text and Women in Performance. He co-edits the book series Sexual Cultures for NYU Press. I should also add that he is a consummate host, a great party giver, and a fellow traveler in the space of loving animals. Welcome back to Duke, Professor Muñoz. It is a pleasure to have you with us here today.
El tiempo es prestado y lo cambia todo. Rostros, relaciones y vecindarios. Ya no quedan muchos como yo. Y me pregunto, ¿qué será de mí? ¿Cómo explicar mi legado? Soy un faro guiando a mis crías fuera de la oscuridad.
Le toca una rola pa' Chucho Pons. Pero pues ese güey no toca. Y enséñale que esto sí es tambor.
A mysterious voiceover has been narrating these first opening images to a heavy and ominous drum sound score. In Spanish, the voice describes how time is borrowed, how it changes everything, and how there are not many like her, and she wonders what will be left of her. Viewers eventually realize that the throaty feminine voice has been assigned to speak for not a person, but a place, a space that holds and shelters brown life within its walls. The camera slows down enough to focus on the back of the head of a figure walking away from it. Another cut and we encounter the filmmaker Wu Sang's face looking up at some illumination long before human beings take a primary role in documentary's unfolding narrative. We witness a commons of lights, shadows, commerce, buildings, trees. It's not until a brown commons is visualized as street, ambience, light, movement, that the documentary's protagonist can come into view. But maybe in the Q&A we can talk about that. Viewers encounter the bar's glimmering sign, its luminous old school beauty suggesting another time and place. The first three shots are scored to throbbing cumbia, as the space erupts with dancers. Nicole's at the door, charging covers, stamping arms while drinks are poured. People circulate within the spaces. The film cuts to the world outside of the bar. Gone are the glittering lights of an alternative every night life, and instead people are shown standing around a corner. Then a cut to a gorgeous shot of an empty bar where the smoke and light twirls, giving the space this otherworldly effect. The viewer encounters the women of the Silver Platter, who introduce themselves, tell us where they're from, describe life at the Silver Platter, and generally revel in the spotlight. One blonde explains she's from Cuba and describes herself as an old bitch. The Silver Platter's voice and Wu's self-narration tell the story of the bar. It's interesting to note that their narratives are rarely aligned. Wu makes observations about his experience of the space and their stories. Wu talks about desires for opening up the bar as a place that could potentially link generations of queer and especially transgendered people. Wu's narration, as we will see, also worries over the potential pitfalls of this project to actualize the expansive potential of the silver platter. But with this desire to expand comes a possibility for danger, the chance that the bar's status as a safe space, this is the word that's thrown around, that accommodates many could perish. Wu worries a great deal about the potential traps in this venue, and the bar counters his concerns by debunking the idea of a safe space, insisting instead that no one person can simply decide who and what is included in a vibrant historical common space like the Silver Platter. The logic of the safe space does not easily hold to a place and situation like this bar. The Silver Platter is a space of encounter. The Silver Platter is a meeting place for many kinds of people. Its materiality is a turbulent thing. Betty, for example, discusses the ways in which the onset of the Wildness Party was met with great disapproval by many of the regular patrons who felt neglected and ignored by the new attendees. She and many of the regulars refused to call the night Wildness and just call it El Martes. Tuesday, Betty thinks, and I'm going to show you another video that plays on that. Betty thinks that the crowd looks like kids from the university, boys and girls who she describes as American and white. Nicole, the door woman, has a very different response. The new crowd excites her. She explains that mingling with people outside her immediate community give her a vaster sense of belonging to the city and the nation. She remarks that despite their differences, they share something, perhaps sexuality, she wonders. There is no consensus, and the Commons is not a space for that. To be of the Brown Commons is not to be in sync, to be lined up. Conflict and disagreement are central to the Commons. The film attempts to document a larger art project. The staging of a party by Wu and three younger queer artists of color, at least one in the case of Wu identifying as transgender, attempting to form a coalition with predominantly working class poor Latina trans women. Certainly the artists, working class slash poor Latina trans women, certainly the artists are not wealthy, and they do manage to do that thing that many cash poor but well educated young artists do. They manage to live a life beyond their actual financial means because of the forms of capital, chiefly cultural, that they have at their disposal. The rich urban ecology of the Brown City is highlighted by shots of a faded neighborhood. The Silver Platter itself explains that MacArthur Park has many layers. She discusses how the economy collapsed in the 70s and 80s, an influx of Latin American migrants and political refugees influenced the environment. Despite urban revitalization, the rents are still cheap, and that's what brings Wu and his friends to the area. Wu's narrative reasserts itself, and he describes how at the age of 23, he moved from Chicago to Los Angeles. In Chicago, he tried to do a certain kind of work in the art scene, but it didn't take hold. Much of that work was related to Chicago's ambitious pilot TV program of the early 2000s. It's interesting how this work can work in Los Angeles in a space like the Silver Platter, but not in Chicago. Once arriving in their neighborhood, the young artists meet Gonzalo, Coqui, and Javier. And this is Coqui, one of the proprietors. They are an interesting queer kinship circle in that one older man who's the actual owner of the bar, his ex-boyfriend and his ex-boyfriend's current boyfriend, and the three of them are like a little kind of unit, and they run the business along with the sister that we saw in the clip earlier. Gonzalo inherited the bar from his brother Rogelio, who had died of AIDS. The three men are supportive of the Tuesday night party, and the influx of new visitors is financially beneficial. Wu explains that their Silver Platter, he finds the sisterhood he was searching for. He seems to form an especially meaningful bond with Erica, who he does not share language with. Erica's a small person with a dreamy look in her eye. Wu explains, and this is Wu describing their relationship. I can't explain what I felt with Erica. My dad never taught me to speak Chinese, how this lack was always a missing piece, and how it is now the way he feels closer to people. It's a thing that is missing for Wu, notable as an inability to communicate one's situation and history, certain muteness in the face of one's history, which draws him to Erica and the silver platter in general. It's for this reason that the force of a kind of brownness beckons. Wu and Erica do not fuse. They feel each other's allure. Their relationality is not predicated on a complete and uncomplicated being in common, but instead on a mysterious being with. During the voiceover about their bond and inability to communicate through conventional means, Wu and Erica are shown hanging out, rolling around in bed together, much like the title of Shiri Maraga and Amber Hallibaugh's famous dialogue from 1981, What We're Doing Rolling Around in Bed Together, wherein which the authors discuss their differences along lines of butch, femme, race, and class. In this case, Erica and Wu's dialogue and language cannot capture their communication. Their allure as two transgendered people communing, being in common, without this linguistic fusion of a full-blown dialogue. Another iteration of this project was recently shown at the New Museum as part of an installation, The Green Room, that attempted to recreate the silver plates, the silver platter in that art space. So this is from last year. It was the New Museum in New York, and it was called The Green Room, and it was an attempt to remake the bar in the museum space. And it had, and this is going to be a tricky part. That installation featured a better perspective of Wu and Erica's communication. It showed a two-channel video called ¿Qué pasó con los martes? What happened with the Tuesdays? And I think this this two-channel video offers a better insight into the characters' relationality. In general, I'm actually much more interested in the installation footage and the other iterations of the project than the actual documentary. But the tricky part is I have to escape my PowerPoint and click a button. And see if it works.
I believe that there's a big future out there with a lot of beautiful things, a lot of handsome men, a lot of luxury.
I want a car.
I want to be with a man.
My love.
I want a nice home away from New York, up the Peekskills, or maybe in Florida, somewhere far where no one knows me.
I want my sex change.
I want to live a normal, happy life, whether it's being married and adopting children, whether it's being famous and rich.
I want to get married in church, in white. Sometimes
they sit and
I look at a magazine.
I try to imagine myself in the front cover or even inside. I want to be a complete woman. And
I want to be a professional model behind cameras in a high fashion world.
I want so much more.
I want my name to be a household product. I want everybody to look at me and say, there goes Octavia.
I want this. This is what I want. And I'm going to go for it.
She didn't deserve all of it. The judges knew it too. Because she was terrible. And her explanation for why she wanted the money, to put it in the bank. She's not getting any money because Sabrina's not going to pay her. They're good friends. It's only publicity and it's bad publicity for Harlem and all the rest because I'm declaring her one of the uglier people of the world. She won't make money off of my name, darling. She can make it off of Harlem and all the rest of the fools that will flock to her, but not Crystal, darling. Anybody but her. You could take all the pictures you want of me, but I better not see them on the street because it's over. Oh, get a picture with me in Harlem and we'll see which is more beautiful, darling. Monique was not here as a friend of yours. She's a friend of mine, darling. Monique, would you tell her why you didn't come? Because she knew it was fixed to Harlow. She said, Crystal, darling, don't go. Because you're not going to get it. And that's why all the true beauties didn't come.
It's showing your color.
I am doing it bad, but I have a right to show my color, darling. I'm beautiful, and I know I'm beautiful.
May I say this to you?
The wrong way.
Taking the wrong way. Shit, she looked bad. And in no way that what you say can do about it. Look at Harlow's outfit. That is but don't bother her. Don't bother her, ha. It's not Harlow's fault. It's not her fault.
I know it's not her fault.
She can't help it because you're beautiful and you're young and you deserve to have the best in life. But you didn't deserve... Missy, I don't say she wasn't beautiful, but she wasn't looking beautiful tonight. She doesn't equal me. Look at her makeup. It's terrible.
If money wasn't so important in the world today to survive, I guess I wouldn't want anything but what I have now. But since money does, I hope that the way I look puts money in my pocket, you know? I'm really working hard. I'm gonna work even harder.
Yeah, there we are. That is lovely. Still? Great, couldn't be better.
I don't want to end up an old drag queen with nothing going for me but trying to win grand prize at a ball.
Yeah, you know, back a little like you did. Yes, that. Twisting a little bit onto the light, just coming around here, yeah, great. Couldn't be better.
I don't think the world has been fair to me. Not yet, anyway.
Yeah, lovely. Lovely.
But you can't tell me a story from your own life of where you learned this, of some...
I could, but it would be my opinion.
Yeah, but I'm interested in your opinion. That's why I'm
talking to
you.
What I'm saying is what I would want you to do is that you...
But this movie is not about me. It's about you.
But see, this movie is about, supposedly about, the ballroom circuit and the gay crew that's involved in this and how each person's life brought them to this circuit.
The ball is as close to reality as we're gonna get to all of that fame and fortune and stardom and spotlights.
A ball is
as close to reality as we're going to get to all of that.
To reality, as
more or less like stardom and
spotlights.
You know, like the Oscars or whatever. Or being on a runway as a model.
Now, it always amazes me how, if you offer something to society,
go ahead.
If you offer something to society that they can use, that is beneficial to them, you're no longer gay. You're a genius. But isn't that ironic? You're a genius?
Glamorous Erica wistfully reflects on her life in LA, but the installation juxtaposes the treacherous trail she has traversed, the dangers she's encountered. Sang's installation keeps the stories in dynamic tension. Her own mysterious being with Erica is not permitted to elide the real material experience of a dangerous and fraught border crossing. In a conversation after the screening, Wu talked to me about how he once used the term brown to describe what was happening in the space on an online forum, which led to his being criticized in the comment section. He was sarcastically asked if Asian was brown now. I hope I've made it clear that in my deployment of the term, Asian could potentially be just that. Not in a way that inhibits us thinking of critical Asianness or even yellowness, but brownness that is co-presence with other modes of difference, a choreography of singularities that touch and contact but do not meld. Brownness is not meant to do anything but coexist with blackness, Asianness, indigeneity, and other terms that have manifest descriptive force to render the particularities of various modes of striving in the world. Brownness is larger than U.S. Latino-centric renderings I'm offering. Latino lives are one portal into this attunement of brownness in the world that I'm calling for. Brownness is certainly larger than the sets of experience that the pluralities of Latin American immigrants and their experience in the United States illustrate. Brownness is not an easy path. It's most certainly a contested debate and a productive one. We cannot foreclose on the Brown Commons reach and its potential. Interesting, the project that became Wildness was first conceived as more of an oral history of the women of the Silver Platter. Indeed, the voices provide much of a running commentary throughout the documentary. The women talk about their vulnerability to violence outside of the confines of the bar, their perilous migrations to Los Angeles, their sense of finding a place at the Silver Platter, their own intergenerational rivalries and so forth. I mean, one rivalry is certainly between the kind of punk kids and the regulars at the Silver Platter. But of course, there are rivalries like between the regulars at the Silver Platter, right? It's not like that is a harmonious sphere either, right? They are often deeply intergenerational rivalries, I might add. When I go extemporaneously, I lose myself. The tensions and the conviviality that is generated by the younger artists and the bar's regulars are described in different ways. Wu becomes concerned that the attention that Wildness is gathering is making it a potentially dangerous space. Creepy characters like washed-up club kid James St. James shows up one night and does a segment on the show for his cable access show, where he harasses the women and the security guards. The LA Weekly includes the club in the Best of LA issue. That piece on the club is incredibly sensational and offensive to the women of the space. Some partygoers turn on Wu and his friends and stencil the sidewalks with the words occupied to symbolize that this Latino space has been occupied by non-Latinos who do not belong. Wu's voiceover let the viewer know that he feels like the wildness of wildness is becoming excessive and the space is in jeopardy. But the bar's narrative contradicts him and explains that there is something that cannot be controlled about the flows of life within the commons, the insurrectionist promise of the encounter. The Wildness Project has one gleaming intertext, and you might have guessed it by now. Jenny Livingston's Paris is Burning. Fang completed a performance for camera that was commissioned as part of the Performa Biennale in 2012. Fang researched the 1991 film at the UCLA archives, where interview transcripts, negatives, and outtakes are stored. He considered the camera as one of the performers for the film's character in a video I'm about to show you. He imagined the performing troupe as doing a kind of seance that was summoning the ghost of the film's past. The video for How We Perceive a Life, Take 3, was shot on 16mm, the same format as Paris is Burning. The duration of the piece is exactly the length of a 400-foot roll of film, because the artist wanted to create a continuous reality out of a fractured one. This is a single-shot take with no editing. The film plays on a 16-millimeter loop. The head is spliced to tail so that it plays continuously, endlessly. There are very specific installation instructions for it. The projector is supposed to be behind a wall that you can see, and it projects through a hole that is cut out of the wall. I want to show a few minutes of that film, for How We Perceive the Life, Take 3. And I think many of you might be familiar with the words of Octavia, Venus, and a very angry crystal. The dancers you will see congeal in a mass on the floor, displaying and touching and being in common, that at first might look like an indeterminate mass, but it soon becomes clear that they do not fuse. Instead, they switch roles, swap positions, fall in line, confront each other, and practice soliloquies. Okay.
believe that there's a big future out there with a lot of beautiful things, a lot of handsome men, a lot of luxury.
I want a car.
I want to be with a man.
My love.
I want a nice home away from New York, up the Peekskills, or maybe in Florida, somewhere far where no one knows me.
I want my sex change.
I want to live a normal, happy life. Whether it's being married and adopting children, whether it's being famous and rich.
I want to get married in church, in white. Sometimes.
They sit and
I look at a magazine.
I try to imagine myself in the front cover or even inside.
I want to be a complete woman. And
I want to be a professional model behind cameras in a high fashion world.
I want so much more.
I want
my name to be a household product.
I want everybody to look at me and say, there goes Octavia.
I want this. This is what I want. And I'm going to go for it.
You know she didn't deserve it. All of it. The judges knew it too. Because she was terrible. And her explanation for why she wanted the money. To put it in the bank. She's not getting any money. Because Sabrina's not going to pay her. They're good friends. It's only publicity and it's bad publicity. For Harlem and all the rest. Because I'm declaring her one of the uglier people of the world. She won't make money off of my name, darling. She can make it off of Harlow and all the rest of the fools that will flock to her. But not Crystal, darling. Anybody but her.
Okay. Stop. Can we have the lights? For the sake of time, I'm going to wrap up. There was another clip I was going to show, and the interesting thing about the video is that Sang's research brought him to the UCLA archives, where he found all the footage, the outtakes of Jenny Livingston's prompts to the documentary subjects, right? So you get to hear what Jenny Livingston said, and I promise you it was crazy. But you can't see that. The holding is so powerful. And the point here is not, we did not reenact this simply as a way to kind of poke fun at Livingston, but more nearly wanted to, in the clips, Livingston talks about how she was part of this ball circuit, and she lived in this ball circuit as well. And the fact that the filmmaker cuts herself out is really the reason that Sang is so interested in injecting herself into it, right? It is literally a reaction formation, right? Two Paris is Burning. The filmmaker's presence in the film. To conclude, I'll consider... Oh, no, that's okay. This is just a page. To conclude, I'll consider the documentary... This is the feature documentary's last sequence. Wu and the women of the Silver Platter sit in daylight in public outside, but they're still within its aura. They're once again spilling over each other, as they did on Erica's bed... and for how we perceived a life. The performance party wildness has since stopped. Many dramas ensued after Gonzalo's death. Wu took sides in a matter that was drawn. A family drama that he regrets. Wildness is a movement that is over, but these transgendered bodies sit together in part. They mingle, still flowing the trajectory of the encounter, which is the inner movement of the Brown Commons. Quote, in the last sequence, Wu's voice reflects on the general experience of wildness. This is Wu. I thought that wildness was about trying to create a movement. I didn't realize until it was over that we're already part of one. It just didn't fit with the stories we were told that we were fighting for. Again, the voice of the Silver Platter is the respondent. How can you capture a story that is full of life and constantly evolving? Wu continues, what we're doing was complicated and flawed, but there was something real there. I could feel it, the Silver Platter. Some, the friendships and dialogues flourished. There was something real there, damaged, imperfect, beautiful. This realization that the filmmaker arrives at, that he was not creating a movement, but part of one, is the salient one here. Wildness, with all its complexity and flaws, is part of a larger trajectory of an encounter that mattered and continues to matter because it's part of the very matter that composes the Brown Commons and all its rich possibility contained within. Brown Commons are not made. One does not bring them into being. Instead, we become attuned to them, and that attunement is not like Wu's discovery that he was not starting a movement, but instead squarely within one. Wildness is the part of the story wildness is in part a story of minor hubris that motivates young queer activists to attempt to author, catalyze, enact, and build a queer, trans, or even brown commons. But this commons exists and routinely staves off the various enclosures that would annihilate it. The film's final scene makes clear that this attempt to touch in the name of a commons can never be about attempting to master or fuse scenes, but instead let the mysteries between us not function as barriers to realizing one's commonness. Instead, it suggests that to know the allure of the commons is to know that one is not simply commencing something new, but instead fortunate enough to be participating in something vaster, partial, incomplete, and ever expanding. Thank you.